Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have Father Matthew Kauth and a video from the St. Joseph Seminary in Charlotte and much more.
Welcome to Life on the Rock this evening. We have a great show ahead for you. Father Matthew Kauth, he's a priest of the Diocese of Charlotte, North Carolina. He's also the rector of a new seminary, St. Joseph College Seminary. When so many college seminaries around the United States are shutting down, the diocese in Charlotte started a new college seminary where so far over 30 guys have entered to discern their vocation for a possible calling to the priesthood.
Next, we go to a message from the St. Joseph Seminary in Charlotte.
St. John Vianney gave a homily. One of the first things he said was, no priest, no mass. No priest, no sacraments. No priest, no church.
The priesthood is essentially an instrument in the hand of God. Not one that he was forced to choose, but the one that he desired. And so a vocation is born by Christ choosing someone and lifting that man with his own consent into his hand. And it's an instrument that he never lets go of.
So I recently read an article about a survey that was done at Georgetown University, and it found that the average age that young men discern a call to the priesthood is 16 years old.
You know, we talk about a vocations crisis as if God has stopped calling people to the priesthood, but he hasn't. There's so much noise in the culture that it's very difficult, even for good young men who are pious and holy and searching, it's very difficult for them to hear that call. So if you have a college seminary, you have an opportunity for them to be in an environment that protects a vocation if there is one there.
For a fruitful ministry in a diocese, we have to have healthy and vibrant priests.
The priesthood is one of the essential ways in which Christ fulfills his promise to be with us always. And as Catholics, there's nothing greater than that.
Priests are so important for bringing Christ to us. That's the way our Lord chose to extend his presence in this world.
Canon law states that every bishop, insofar as he can, should have his own seminary, in particular the college seminary. And the reason for that is that a vocation is considered like a seed. It needs to be planted somewhere to be able to be cultivated, to be nurtured, to be protected, so that it might bring forth fruit. And that seed bed is what we call literally a seminary. That's what a seminary means. And so when a young man has the opportunity to throw himself at our Lord in that courageous movement at 18 years old, 19 years old, 20 years old, the idea is to protect that vocation.
Priesthood, of course, is a special calling, and it requires a special intellectual and human and spiritual formation. The dream is to be able to have a priest in every parish, and our parishes are growing, and so it is essential that we form young men to be ready to take up their places in the parishes when the time comes.
The first step in building a good priest is to build the man. You can't have the priest if you don't have the foundation. The foundation upon which that grace is given is the man.
One learns to be a priest by being with priests, by watching them, by shadowing them, and being formed.
To be a man of God, you have to be a man. And that means virtue. They have to be a man of virtue. We teach what it's like to live a virtuous life.
We have all heard Christ's words speaking about leaven or yeast, in which something so small becomes so large, like a mustard seed. But to see it in action has been astounding, even for us. So in just 3 years, we have 24 men in the seminary. So the need now that we have to build is essential.
So we keep moving forward, and the next stage is then to be providing a place for them where they can all be together and undergo their formation together.
What sets us apart is principally because we are priests of our own diocese, serving our own seminarians. These are our sons, and one day they will be our brothers. You are living with, you are working with, you are praying with, you are eating with the men that will be your brothers for the rest of your life. It's very familial.
Who are the priests that are going to serve my grandchildren? Are they going to be good, holy Catholic priests, formed well, educated well? You know, are they going to be the ones that help get my grandchildren to heaven? I sure hope so. You know, and that's worth getting involved over.
I asked the Lord in what way I can follow him to Calvary so I can die on the cross with him. And he answered that prayer, and particularly during Mass, where I saw that the priest walks with our Lord and lays his life down during every sacrifice of the Mass.
When I was in high school, I didn't really have like a big aha moment about going to seminary or the priesthood, but I thought about it a lot throughout high school and just kind of felt this constant pull or this constant desire to go. I wasn't so sure how to do it though, because there wasn't a seminary in the diocese.
God willing, I am ordained. I am looking forward to being that mediator, the intercessor for the people, to bring them to God and then to bring God to them through the sacrifice of the Mass, bringing them the Most Holy Eucharist, and then through confession, bringing them back to God.
Again, I was asking all these questions. What is the point of being a man? A man has to sacrifice himself. What will I sacrifice myself for? And as I started answering these questions, I realized that I wanted to sacrifice myself for the gospel, that I wanted to be able to bring our Lord to other people. This merciful Lord that had mercy on me, I wanted to be able to give it to others.
As a kid, I just wanted to go into medicine, and I feel like it was because I just wanted to help people. You know, what a better way to help people than bringing Christ to them.
These are going to be our future priests, our future shepherds who are going to guide the flock. And no matter how big or small, whatever you can afford, we all have an obligation to help them in some way and to be a part of something that's so much bigger than ourselves.
St. John Paul II, he once said, "The future of vocations is in God's hands, but it's also in our hands as well."
Without the priest, the Eucharist is no more. And therefore, the priest is something that whose importance couldn't really be overstated, simply by God's designs.
This is something really big for the future, not only of the Diocese of Charlotte, but for the future of Catholicism in the South and throughout the country.
From an investment standpoint, it's an eternal investment, and it's well worth it.
Father Matthew Kauth, it's great to have you here. You're a great friend of our sisters, Mother Dolores and Poor Claire's. And I think out of that is a good relationship you're a great leader in priest and formation in general. Let's talk a little bit about this new initiative, St. Joseph Seminary, that started. How did it get started? It just didn't come out of nowhere.
Certainly. Indeed, the relationship that I have with the sisters was part of the providence of the entire thing, because they were praying at a particular convent there on the campus of St. Anne, specifically for vocations and specifically for a seminary. What we didn't know is that the seminary would then be housed there when the sisters were asked to go back.
So they were the seedbed.
They were the first seedbed. And it was St. Joseph's Monastery, now it's St. Joseph's Seminary.
Sure.
But the ultimate initiative began many years back, certainly with creating a bit of a culture of vocations. You can have a fallow field, it's still going to produce some kind of fruit, but not necessarily the fruit that you want.
Yeah.
So the cultivation of the field in its inception had to do really with our encouraging of vocations, first by having really strong watchdogs at the entry door, and then secondly, we began discernment days in our diocese years ago, along with our Eucharistic Congress. That developed over the course of time into a five-day retreat called Quo Vadis, which was begun in Pennsylvania originally.
Yeah.
So we sort of took that model and tailored it to our own uses, because we saw so many vocations, at least inquiries among vocations, coming amongst men that were in high school. And the recent CARE report that came out stated the same thing, was that most men are thinking about the priesthood, if they do, around the age of 16.
Is that right?
And so often we're losing them by letting them go off and wait until they come back with a degree or don't come back.
Do you think it's helpful to invite that young, just invite young guys to just consider it, to pray about it?
Well, who has the tools for discernment at that age? Yeah. Right? The culture is a very bad formator of men.
Yeah.
And so to get them away from their phones, to get them out of their homes in the summertime around other men, just so they could even see that not only the seminarians that we have, but then other young men their age, like themselves, are asking the fundamental question, what am I going to do with my life? What does God want from me? That's been extremely successful. So we began, the bishop asked me if I would sort of lead the charge on this many years ago. We put the program together, and it went through, as a friend of mine likes to say, 1,000 deaths and 1,000 resurrections to get it started. We encountered no
going
small,
back to the drawing board. And, let's start over.
So many obstacles. But finally,
that shows that it's meant to happen.
I think so.
That's why you persevered.
Amen. Amen. The one thing the bishop kept saying is, keep moving forward.
Yeah.
Keep moving forward. And in 2016, when we were getting close to that point at which he either had to pull the throttle and take off, or he had to give it up, I remember calling him and saying, now is the time, or it's not the time. Mm. We've invested time, we haven't invested anything else. Mm. So you make the call, obviously. And the bishop said, let's go. And so in 2016, on the Feast of St. Joseph, he formally erected the seminary, but we had nowhere to live, nor any idea if anyone would actually come. We had inquiries, we had interest among the young men, but no idea if it'd be successful. And that was the point at which the sisters were asked to go back to Hansville.
Yes.
And so their monastery convent was open. We had 8 rooms, 8 men signed up.
Yeah, which I know was bittersweet, losing them.
Difficult.
But at the same time, it's like, look what gave birth.
It was.
It was a rebirth.
And every room was filled the first year.
That's
second year, we bought a house. We had 8 rooms, 8 men signed up. The third year, the same thing. We just purchased our 4th house because we've had over 30 men come through in a short amount of time.
Talk about formation there, the emphasis on formation that you have. Mm-hmm. In the culture that we live in today, there's a greater need in the church for greater human formation and greater spiritual formation.
Absolutely.
Can you just talk about those pillars?
When a young man comes, obviously we're attempting to take the best that we can find among the young men. At the same time, they're highly influenced by the culture. You can't not be. It's a sort of toxic environment. And so you have to kind of burrow down to the foundations of the young man and find out what's kind of holding him up. So our specific emphasis in the seminary is really on human formation. We emphasize the virtues, how to grow in the virtuous life. And we don't do so by virtue of simply filling their heads with knowledge.
Yes.
It's important. We have a very rigorous intellectual program. But virtue has to be enacted. It has to be enfleshed. And so we live with the men, we eat with the men, we do what they do. If he's got to take out the trash, I've got to take out the trash. Mm-hmm. Everyone does the same thing.
Yeah.
We all live under a very difficult, at first difficult, rule of life.
Yes.
And then that rule becomes the means of their own freedom. And
that's what virtue is, really.
Absolutely.
You know, how you grow in freedom.
Absolutely. So we emphasize mostly the two pillars of the human formation and the spiritual life. The men spend a solid 3 to 4 hours a day in prayer, in addition to all their academics, their recreation, and everything else.
And there's an emphasis on the classical tradition.
That's
where
right.
they're learning
That's
Latin.
Right.
They're actually speaking
That's
in
right.
Latin as well
it's
as they can.
It's pretty wild. When they enter, we have a wonderful teacher, Dr. Nancy Llewellyn, who is a world-renowned Latinist, and she assists us in giving these men an immersion program in Latin. So they learn to speak it like a child learns to speak.
Hmm.
And we're leveraging off Belmont Abbey College, which has been a wonderful marriage for us, to work with them and the great resources that they have. So we've been able to get our men into their new honors program at the college. So they're learning a classical education with Latin as the emphasis, but in very rigorous philosophy studies as well.
Yeah. And the last year is a capstone course.
That's right.
Where they go to Rome and you kind of incarnate everything that they learn to show them how everything weaves into the tradition of the church.
Absolutely. We sort of bring them back to Peter.
Yeah.
At the end of our entire time together, in terms of college seminary, bring them to the feet of Peter, as it were, and make the creed. Say the creed. This is what you believe, and this is why you believe it. Now you've got some foundation upon which we can begin to build the priesthood.
Now, that capstone course, that kind of weaves into how you wrote this book.
That's right.
You know, you were asked by 10 books to write a book on the sacraments, and initially you were a little bit hesitant, but you thought, well, maybe this could possibly contribute to how we do this capstone program. So when we come back, we're going to talk about specifically about your book and about the sacramental life of the church and how we can grow in our understanding of the greatest gift that God has given us in the sacraments.
Amen. All
right. Matthew, it's great to have you.
Thanks for having me.
This book, I want to recommend everybody get this book, you know, just to buy it for an early, you know, stocking stuffer. it's just a great book on the sacraments, just talking about the sacramental life of the church and just, you know, how we enter into, you know, God's plan for us, you know, to be changed, you know, to be transformed by the renewal of our mind. Mm. And just, can you give us a good taste of how you start out and what is a sacrament? Mm-hmm. And why did Christ institute the sacraments?
Absolutely. One of the things that we don't think about very often is the fact that every time we're in a relationship with someone, they take a lot of interior space. Hmm. In other words, it's as if someone moves in, right? Whenever we fall in love, for example, for the first time and we're infatuated with someone, they take up a massive amount of retail space, as it were, in the mind, mm-hmm. And in the heart, because we're thinking about them, we're attached to them, we're willing to be with them, we want to be with them, we want their good at the highest level. But they, in some sense, reside in us, even though that kind of residing is generated at that point by ourselves, because we see someone that we love. It's just a sign, as is a mother and child, that persons were made to dwell inside of persons. That's the kind of creatures that we are, because we're made in the image and likeness of a God who's three persons.
Yes.
And as a result of that, we feel the absence, as it were, if no one's dwelling inside. The problem is that the generation that you and I have, when we love someone that we're in a relationship with, as good as it is, it's not really an indwelling.
Yeah.
In the kind of way in
which God indwells.
God desires to dwell in us. Hmm. And so the sacraments are the very means, not that he had to choose, but that he desired.
He wills.
He wills to instill us, not just with a thought about him or a historical memory of him, but actually the means by which he begins to dwell inside of us.
So we can be changed. You know, we believe that grace can transform human nature.
Absolutely.
You know, can elevate human nature.
Absolutely.
And just talking, going into the sacraments in general, the sacraments themselves, baptism, you know, making a divine child, adopted child, you know, into the sonship of Christ. You know, what does it mean to be baptized?
Right. So one of the things with the sacraments that we don't think about either is that the word itself just means a sign. And that can have a sort of almost a negative connotation that, oh, it's just a sign of something. What's true? The Old Testament had a kind of sacrament, right? When God would appear to someone, he'd erect an altar, right? Or mark the spot, or do the same thing that he did back then and his fathers did before him. A sign that he is part of in a relationship with God. The problem is the sign wasn't efficacious. Hmm. Well, when we want to know what God is doing, and then we look at the sacraments, it's not simply what he did in one given occasion, but these are the means by which he does it. Yeah. So the word sacrament, first of all, means a sign, but it's an efficacious sign. And so baptism is a perfect example. So you ask yourself the question, what does the sign signify?
Yes.
So any word that I use, if I use the word cat, it's just a symbol, right? A symbol for the concept that you have in your mind. We can use a different language and we have a different word because the symbol isn't the reality. But in this case, the sign that's given is telling you what reality you're receiving. What kind of grace are you receiving at that moment? So it takes something as simple as water. What does it signify to us on a natural level? Everyone, every child knows that it signifies purity, right? Mm. If I don't use it, right?
Yes.
I'm gonna get in trouble with my mom when I'm a kid,
yes.
Right? I gotta wash, right? I wanna be purified. But also a sign of life. If I don't drink it, I don't live. Mm-hmm. And as a result, God uses the elements that he created with the knowledge that he was going to use them. to instill life in us. So imagine when he was making, creating water, when that's in his mind from all eternity, he's doing so with the very view of giving us divine life. Like when you look, why are we so attracted by water? We want to sit at a seascape or something. This is the substance he knew from all eternity was going to be the vehicle, almost like an aqueduct, to transmit his divine life to us. So the sign tells us that. It's about purity and giving life.
Yeah.
And then we add another sign on top of that, which are the words of Christ.
Hmm.
So two different signifiers, and by Christ, who is the principal agent in the sacrament, makes that efficacious. So when the priest says, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, a further signification in the water, but now you know what grace you're receiving.
Hmm.
Right? The grace of sonship.
Yeah.
The grace of divine life, that purified of original sin, and participating now in an entirely different life, because you weren't meant to have a human life simply,
yeah,
but a divine one. And you can see that with the sign.
Yeah, and especially in Eucharist, where where the Lord wants to feed us with his body and
absolutely
blood, so that, you know, we are, may have eternal life, not in heaven, but now,
right,
here on earth.
Right.
And what does it mean
actually,
actually now?
Absolutely. The Eucharist is a fascinating one to discuss, and it's
yes,
so hard to put it into a small book,
oh,
obviously.
Sure.
Because in this case, the sign does say something, right? What is the sign saying to us in terms of bread, but the nourishment? It's nourishing the life that I received before in terms of divine life. But a bit more than that, right? And then the precious blood, of course, is a common signifier of joy.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But the difficulty in this case is, whereas God uses almost as a flowing power, flowing through water, when the baptism is over, I mean, the water might be blessed, but that power is no longer in the water. Whereas the Eucharist is a bit different. It's the only sacrament in which, that of which it is a sign, it's the real thing.
Yes.
This is the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ, which nourishes the divine life that he gave you and brings joy to your heart because of the communion that you have with him in charity.
You know, Father, in the remaining minute that we have, you know, talk about the sacrament of penance, because a lot of people don't understand the sacrament of penance, or perhaps are afraid of the sacrament of penance, afraid of revealing themselves and becoming vulnerable. But that sacrament is a sacrament of healing, you know, a sacrament of restoration that
absolutely
points us back to the Eucharist.
Absolutely. G.K. Chesterton was once asked, how can you confess your sins? You sin one day, you go to confession, you go do the same thing again. It just seems so easy. You Catholics are just playing around with magic. And he said, it's not easy. It's the hardest thing that I ever have to do, is face the truth about myself. And yet when we ask the question, why God did it, why do I have to tell another person my sins? Because sin is personal.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's only for the reason of facing the truth, which it is, certainly, right? We face the truth when we have to tell another person so that we see it. It's not as if God doesn't see it, but do we see it? But secondarily, and this is something I think people should really consider, especially as a impetus to go to confession, which is that one of the reasons he set it up this way is so that you can hear that you're forgiven.
Yeah.
That you can know that. You don't have to guess.
Yeah.
It's efficacious. There's no more pleasing words, I think, for a Catholic to hear ever than, yeah, I absolve you.
I know. And you just feel this sort of a relief.
Absolutely.
You know, Father Matthew, we could go, you know, on and on about I love the study of the sacraments and just talking about the sacraments. We're going to have you back again to talk about,
love to,
you know, the life of the seminary at St. Joseph's, and also, you know, possibly just unraveling your book, and, you know, that'll be great.
It'd be a pleasure.
Thank you so much
for
coming, Father.
God bless.
God bless you. Brother John, it was a great interview. We talked about the sacraments and the sacraments in general, the nature of the sacraments, baptism and the Eucharist. We really didn't have time to talk about a whole lot. We ended with the sacrament of penance, but we really could have talked for another hour about the sacraments and divine life and how God comes to dwell within us, to heal us, and to make us his dwelling place.
He does. And I think that's a beautiful thing, that to really get in touch with the sacraments, we need priests,
yeah,
you know, and we need men to discern that calling to the priesthood. And, you know, there, and even in the seminary, we all have a unique story to tell about our own lives.
Yes.
But you know, in the world today, there's a lot of chaos and there's a lot of noise. Mm-hmm. But you know, what we go into the seminary and tell our formators, a lot of them have heard before, they know the struggles, they know the temptations, they know how to build you up. And they want to build you up in the image of Christ, mm-hmm. and send you out so that people can have that opportunity to receive the sacraments.
Sure, and that's our Go Into the Vineyard challenge today is give it a try.
That's right.
Give the seminary a try. Yeah. There's only so much discerning that you can do outside of seminary. Just give it a try. Contact your vocation director, contact a religious community, and just go give it a try. May the blessing of Almighty God through the intercession of St. Maximilian Kolbe, a great priest of God, be upon you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We'll see you next time on Life on the Rock. God bless you.
Attractive word, but it's not always what it seems. I wonder if I really know what the true definition means. The song from the 70s, the Bee Gees, provokes questions in my head. How deep is your love? Do you know what it all meant? When you lay down on the floor and gave it all away, did you really count the cost? Do you really live that way? I'm looking at the cross and I'm picturing the sacred kenosis. He poured out his love in buckets, not in small doses. And the truth is, I need to keep looking right at it and seek to live passionately for the passion and not move past it. It's so easy to guard myself from the essence of sacrifice and play the same mind game and do just enough to get by.
You don't know,
but that's not what it is to be great. It's not what it is to be a saint. I don't want to be dead bones in a box, washed white with paint. If I step out on the water, I better stop and count the cost. The stakes are too high, wandering in this land of the lost. Eloquent words, our king is so quotable. We print his verses everywhere, it's just so notable. And if I remember correctly, Jesus said, I am the way. He is not one among wise men, the words they say. If you put his words on your lips, check the tag for the price. You can't say that you know him unless you live sacrifice. I never knew a Jesus peace to bring a man peace. Head nods in God's direction don't make a restless heart cease. Your cross, your call, it's something specific for you to do. And without a deep yes and its actions, it's, I never knew you. Look for him. The heart only settles on what is true. His eyes indeed look for yours and mine. Allow him to find you.
What love is.